in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And He's coming back. He's coming. He's coming back again. We believe. We believe.
Yeah. our prayer this morning. It's the next song we play. Let us be our prayer. As you let God rule and reign this morning, let His presence be in our midst as we sing this last part.
Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. And we overcome by Your presence.
God, how great You are. Today is all Yours, Father. Glorify Yourself in today. May all things is done today bring honor and glory to Yourself.
Thank you. turn into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. And in the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power. Our God. Our God.
Alpha and the Omega. So today is God's Word. Let's look at Genesis
chapter 1, what His Word tells us in verses 1, this is the foundation of our gospel, this is the foundation of our life. It says these first five words, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's my favorite verse of the whole entire Bible, believe it or not. My favorite verse. You know why? Because all of creation, everything we have, every time you open your eyes, is all in these first five words that says, in the beginning, God created. In other words, everything we have, every time you open your eyes, all the beauty and all the glory, we know it all comes from one being. One being our loving God. It does not explain where He comes from. It just says God's always been there. But it says He created all things. Now watch this. Not only did He create the animal kingdom, the plant kingdom, and mankind, but you know what else God created? He will make sure from the very beginning that our whole entire life has been planned out. So God also created the workforce in the first three chapters. God also created marriage in the first three verses, in the first three chapters. So if you're happy today and you're married, say amen.
Amen.
If you're happy and you know it, say amen.
Amen.
If you're happy and you want to be happy, just say amen anyway. He created marriage. How many of you happy to have children? Say amen.
Amen.
He created those too. He created the birth process. All things from the very, very beginning, our Lord God made it. Why did He make it? You know why He made everything for us? Because He loves you. He loves you so much. He doesn't just stop at the beginning. Just hold on, I'm going to get to the message in a minute. Brother Jeffrey, I got 14 minutes. Time me, okay? He holds his clock up here in a minute. 14 minutes, here we go. But also God, the word goes on to the New Testament. We all know what John 1:1 says. It says, in the beginning, speaking about creation, was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So we know from this very passage that not only was God involved in creation, but it says that the Word was involved in creation. Now, who is the Word? Come on, shout out if you know it. Jesus, Almighty God, our Messiah, the one that lived and died and breathed for us, the one that rose from the grave for us. It says, in the beginning was God. But this verse, it says, but with God was the Logos, was the Word, the Almighty Jesus. So we know in the creation there was God, the Father. Also there was God, the Son, being Jesus. And also the Bible says in Genesis chapter 1 that the Spirit of God hovering over the waters. So what we see is the Holy Spirit also involved all in creation. Then it says in John 1:1 that the Word was God. It did not say the Word was like a God or looked like a God, but it says Jesus is God. So we know from the very beginning there's always been Christ. From the very beginning He's always had a plan for us. But how many know this? His plans don't just start for you. God never starts something without finishing something. He never is going to start something in our life without bringing it to fruition. The Bible says once we become Christians, we produce fruit. In other words, He starts us out as a small plant, but He wants us to grow and to blossom and to produce more fruit and to grow more trees. That's what God's plan is for us. So we know in the very beginning God created us. Now let's look at the very end. Let's look at God's final end. Revelation chapter 22 says this in verses 13. Revelation 22 says this in verses 13. This is all God Almighty speaking, and God says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. I'm the beginning and I'm the end. I'm the first and I'm the last. Well, say this with me. I want you all to say this with me. See, well, I'll get this. Say beginning.
Beginning.
Now say the end.
End.
At the beginning.
At the end.
You know what you see throughout the beginning and throughout the end? You know what you see? You see Jesus. From all this, it says that He is the Alpha and Omega. We know what this means. For our English alphabet, we have the letter A. Look in your dictionary, you see that's the first letter in all your dictionaries. And all the words we invent in the English language all revolve around 26 letters. All starts with A and ends with Z. It isn't that way in the Greek language. It starts with the letter Alpha, ends in the letter Omega. So what Christ is saying is, I'm the first of all knowledge. I'm the end of all knowledge. All things come into being because of who He is. So this verse we're going to look at today is this. Starting in our early days, in the very beginning, what I call the ABCs of salvation. You ever heard that? We've all heard the ABCs of salvation. Don't worry, that's not my message. You're not coming in to hear the ABCs of salvation. We all know those. Chances are very likely in this church today, many of you accepted Christ in this building. Many of you believed the Lord Jesus Christ at old-fashioned altars like this, a place where you knelt down and you invited God to save your soul, and you realized you were a sinner and needed a loving God to save you. So really quickly, for those who've never heard it, this is just for those. If you've already heard it, just turn off for 2 seconds and just think of the food here in just a minute, okay? You ready? Here it is, the ABCs of salvation. First, really quickly, admit. Admit you're a sinner. Admit we all fall short of God's glory. Secondly, it says believe. Believe that Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. Believe He came to take the punishment for us. Now, how many can say this? We're all raised in the South. Many of us are, aren't we? Proud to be raised country boys. How many have picked country girls? How many country boys and country girls have ever been disciplined for? Be honest. How many can use about 4 more right now? Anybody? Remember, how were you disciplined back in the day? How did mommy and daddy discipline you? Think times have changed. Now we just say, don't do that again. But back in the day, I got disciplined pretty good, didn't I? And you got disciplined pretty good. How did you get disciplined? Usually with about a 4-inch belt, or a switch, or a hand, or a wooden spoon, or something that always disciplines us. And sometimes discipline hurts, don't it? But the Bible says we discipline those that we love. So we discipline those. But watch this. Because of wrongdoing, we get punished. But here's the thing about it. Because of our wrongdoing, our Savior came down from the throne and took that punishment for us. One of the greatest days, I was telling some people here at VBS the other day. One of the saddest days, I had to discipline my oldest daughter. And she was about 4 years old. She did something she should not have said. She actually said a bad word. She said the word stupid. And that was a bad word in our house. So we had to say, baby, you can't say that word no more. So I had to go, and I told her, so go get across the bed and go ahead and get grandma spanking one time. So she went across the bed, she laid and she said, Daddy, please don't spank me very hard. I'm so sorry. I said, watch this. Time for a teaching lesson. And I said, baby, watch. Stand up and watch. And I got myself and I spanked myself across the backside. And she cried more than she's ever cried in her whole life. Saying, Daddy, why don't you take the spanking for me? Because Jesus took it for me. That's what believing, that Christ took the punishment for you. Then not only that, but confess it. Confess to the world. Don't be ashamed that He took those stripes for you. Don't be ashamed of Him. Because the Bible says if you're ashamed of Him, He'll be ashamed of you. So that's the ABCs. Now, all of that we all started in the very parts of salvation. Today I'm going to finish it up. I'm calling this one the WXYZ and Z's of the Christian walk. The WXYZ's of the Christian walk. I'm going to get close to time, Brother Jeffrey. Getting close. Y'all, don't listen to him. You don't want to take all the time. How can we all know where our faith started, but how can we grow in our Christian faith? How can we grow stronger to the Lord? And I often ask our congregation this question. How many can say right now, you are as close to the Lord as you want to be? Anybody say that? Because we know this life is hard. This life throws its curveballs. This life is difficult at times. But see, what Christ started in us, He wants to finish with us. It says that this life is like a race. They want to get through this race till get to heaven. So how do we finish up? How can we live this Christian life? How do we like us to? We all know the W. First is worship.
You know what worship is? This church house is full of people who come today hopefully to worship. Churches across this country today are full of people who supposedly are supposed to be in churches, not just for the food, or the fellowship, which is great. Those are great things. But the most important thing about church is when the family gets together and the family worships together. Worship started in the home. And we get together as a church, we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. And what we're called to do is all worship as one big family. And how do you worship? What is the definition of true kind of worship? I got to preach a revival. It's about 8 years ago. It's in North Georgia, way above Atlanta, near Chattanooga area. Preached a revival there. And it's a big, huge church. You think a church with 5 deacons is tough? Imagine having one with 35 deacons. They had a bunch of deacons in this church. So what happens is I ask all the deacons to pass out little small index cards before the revival started. And my first night's message was on gratitude, how to truly worship the Lord. And I asked everybody in the congregation to, on that card, write one thing that you're thankful to God for. One thing. Can you think of one thing you're thankful to God for? At least one. And what happened is after I asked all the deacons to pass all those up, all congregation, a bunch of that I stacked about that high of index cards. And when I started my message, what I was going to do is, I'm not going to call their names out, but I'm going to say, and somebody in today's congregation is happy for their family. Somebody today is happy because God saved them. Some folks are thankful because God gave them their sins, took their sins from them. I went to 3 or 4 of those cards, and I got the one that says, and I'm thankful for absolutely nothing. Yeah. How can you be thankful for absolutely nothing? You think of a reason to worship God today? You think of a reason, look at the ones around you. Look at your loved ones. You got money in your bank account? That'd be a whole lot, but you have some. You got clothes on your back. You got somebody that loves you. You got a Heavenly Father. You got a future home in glory. What worship really is humbling yourself and truly showing gratitude to Him. Coming back and you're simply saying thank you for what you've done. Here's the second one. What X? Don't laugh at my expression. But X-ray. The Bible says that if we examine ourselves, we're to examine ourselves. It says if we judge ourselves, we would not be judged. So we're to look at this life every single day and see if this life is lining up with the life of Jesus. And chances are, we fall short, don't we? We're not nowhere near like He is. We're to examine our life to see how we line up with Christ's principles. You never broke a bone before? That ain't the most wonderful thing in the whole entire world. I broke 3 bones in my life. My first bone I got to break was actually 2 bones in one. I got to jump out of an airplane one time. I know what you're thinking. What person in their right mind ever jumps out of an airplane? I was in the Army. It paid $200 extra a month, so why not? I was money hungry. So I said, if I jump out of an airplane, I will get $200 extra a month. So I jumped out and broke both my feet, both my ankles, just like that. Healed back up, got to do it all over again. That's my first 2 bones I broke. My second one was on a football game, and I'm on a motorcycle driving to work. I got there, out there, and I drive on a motorcycle. All of a sudden, somebody pulled out in front of me. I had 2 choices. Number one, hit him from the rear end. Or number 2, lay down and go into the pond. So I laid it down and slid off on the asphalt right into the lagoon at Troy University. And there I am, just soaking wet. I got up, my hips hurting like crazy. The chief says, can you still work the rest of the day? We want you to still be here. I said, I'm going to try. So I finished up the rest of the shift, had a crazy party that night. The next day, I had to go to church. And I was preaching that next morning in church. That afternoon, I was still hurting. Went to the doctor, and he says, how are you still walking? You got a broke pelvis. I don't know how you still doing, but how are you still walking? There's sometimes pain involved. But you know how you're going to see inside of you? You know how you see what's broke inside of you? You look at the x-ray. And the x-ray tells exactly what's wrong with you. A lot of believers all across the world today look good on the outside, don't they? Had their makeup done right, their hair done right. They look beautiful on the outside. They have the nice suits on, but inside they're broken. inside that don't match up to God's expectations. So every day examine your life. Next one is yield. Yield to God. You know what yield means? How many have a driver's license? How many have it revoked? No, I'm going to say they don't have it revoked. I'll get you at the church. No. Driver's license. We all know what yield means. If you do not know what yield means, chances are very likely you've been in a lot of wrecks in your life, haven't you? Here's what yield means. When you come to that sign, you slow down. Sometimes you've got to stop and let the person that's leading go ahead in front of you. Yield. And that's how we yield to God. That's how we yield our ways to God. And I want to share this story. We're going back up one really quickly. When it goes to extra in our life. She told me not to say it, I'll say it anyway, because I believe in bragging upon her loved ones, right? I got a good little wife. She just come with, she's hoping on her way back right now. They had a wedding last night in Georgia with her cousins and her kinfolks. But on Father's Day, we're sitting in the house. And I asked her, I said, Jessica, you want to call your father and tell him happy Father's Day? And they had a really rough situation. Divorced the mom, it was a real bad split up. And she had a hard time forgiving for that. Because really, the way she did it, that she, her mom was treated. I said, Jessica, you want to call your dad and tell him happy Father's Day? I can't do it. But don't forgive him. And I suggest, don't you realize that God says if we don't forgive those, he won't forgive us. So we're supposed to forgive each other. I said, don't forget about it. Don't forgive what he did wrong. But I forgive him as a person. Because I'm not willing to go to hell for anybody. I want to forgive you. So why don't you forgive him? And she began to cry. And cry. And the whole conversation went from being just about forgetting and forgiving. And my little wife, all 4 foot 11 inches of her, 5 foot if you ask her, she said, Daniel, if I died right now, I'm not going to heaven. The preacher's wife told the preacher that if she was to die right then, she would not go to heaven. We begin to examine her life, and I said, we're not leaving this room today till we leave here knowing you're going to go to heaven. I'm not going to go by myself. And all of a sudden, we started praying. We started reading God's Word together. He started just assuring her. And all of a sudden, about 5 minutes later, she stood up, and she goes, for the first time in my life, I know right now where I'd go. And my little 4'11" wife, for the first time in her life in 35 years, accepted Christ. If I know a preacher's wife struggles with assurance of salvation, I know we all struggle with assurance of salvation. But God wants us to worship Him, to examine our life, to see how we match up, and yield to His Spirit, yield to His way. And the last one is this one, is zeal. Zeal means passion. How many of you first started out being a first-time Christian? You started out being on fire for God. You wanted to sing, you wanted to preach, you wanted to walk the streets. Everybody you saw, you wanted to tell about Jesus. You couldn't shut you up. But something happened, didn't it? Because negativity set in, didn't it? My whole career, here's what I've always heard. You talk too fast, you talk too loud, you ain't the best preacher in the world, you talk too redneck, you need more education, you can't sing, you can't play guitar, you've never had that praise and worship here in this house. I heard all that kind of stuff my whole career. But if you listen to all the negativity, you won't listen to His voice. If you listen to all the junk the world's throwing at you, a Christian is not going to discourage you. We're called to encourage. Now here's an encouragement. You're not the best singer, but you keep trying. Not the best guitar player, but keep trying. That's how we're called to encourage. And here's what we're called to do. Keep having that zeal and that passion. Keep listening to His voice. Quit trying to please man. Quit saying, I don't care what somebody thinks about me. I don't care what somebody says about me. I don't care how he thinks about me. That's what's the most important. And everything you do, from the way you do your job, to the way you live your life, the way you raise your kids, the way you treat those around you, if you simply have the terminology and the mentality, I'm not doing it for them, I'm doing it for Him. And everything you do, have a passion to serve Him. Now you're living out to the end. That's how we live out our Christian faith. So you're already there yet? We've already admitted many of us have. We admitted we're failures. We admitted we sinned. We admitted we messed up. We believe in Jesus Christ. Many of us have confessed Him as our Lord and Savior. That's the beginning. But we have to get to the end. We weren't called just to save us and sit on a bench. He's called us to save us and push us to glory. And then we end up, are you worshiping? Are you examining your life daily? Are you yielding His Spirit? And are you really passionate, having that zeal for Him? I'm going to get our song leader, our piano player, to come this morning. Let's all stand really quickly. I know the chicken's getting cold. I know. You got a microwave. I promise you it works. I checked before I come out here. Really quickly, I want you to do one thing. Really quickly, I want to take just a second. Right where you're at. Unless it's not your home church, many of you it's not, you're just visiting with us or being our guest, and thank you for doing that. I want you to do this. It's not about the person beside you, the person in front of you. It's not about anybody else in this whole entire building. It's all about you and your relationship with Him. And how you stand before Him right now. And just for anybody, bow your head really quickly. Get some place off. And examine your life right now. Look in your life right now. And see if you're lining up the way He wants you to line up. And see if you're living as close to Him as you possibly can. Or you can stand some improvement. Our God loves you. He's not going to discipline you. He's not going to chastise you. He wants to save you. He wants to show you His love and give you His Spirit. He wants to empower you. He wants to show you how much He truly loves you. And just a moment, I ask you. You start singing here, just a moment. If you come to the conclusion that you're not, your life is not right yet, but you want it to be, this altar's going to be open. I'm going to ask you to come forward and just simply kneel down and pray. It's a place where we all come and just kneel down before God and admit our faults. The altar's going to be open this morning. All it takes is a little bit of courage to step out on faith and say, God, I'm not there. And God will come to you. If all we can just simply take that first step, He'll run to us. This is one of us sing God's Word.